Hello, and welcome to Worship with St. Luke's United Church. My name is Rick Gunn, and I'm the minister in this very good place. I'm coming to you today from my new home in White's Lake, and it looks pretty tidy what you're seeing here, but over here is a complete and utter mess of boxes and things. I'm in such upheaval that I have left your beautiful worship candle and the singing bowl at my parents' house in Fall River. So today we have a different candle and no singing bowl at all. But I think we can worship God just the same. If you haven't been part of the St. Luke's community, but you're enjoying watching these online services and you're nearby, we pray that you'll consider coming in person when we are allowed to open up again, and it'd be wonderful to connect physically with you. But if online is our way, then this is good too. We acknowledge that we gather in Mi'kma'ki, the ancestral and unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq people. This territory is covered by the treaties of peace and friendship with the Mi'kmaq people. Part of acknowledging traditional territory like I'm doing right now and its experience of colonialism calls on us to consider our relationship with the land. Our presence in Mi'kma'ki means we are implicated to reconcile for past and present wrongs and to commit ourselves to the ongoing work of reconciliation. We are all on this land treaty people. Allow me to light our Christ candle to bring more light symbolically and literally into our lives. Are you ready to worship? I hope so. Let us pray. God of seeds and God of hope, in this time of worship, we are making time for our relationship with you. We give thanks that you are always with us, even when we forget you are. Bless us as we sing, hear your holy word, reflect upon it with our hearts and our minds, and may we be open to serving your hurting world in a new and more loving way. We pray for you to change us, God. That's what worship is about. Make us more like Christ. In his strong name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Creation is wondrous. It's awesome. And as I've been personally grappling with all the difficult news we've received in the last couple weeks, I've also been doing my best to focus on that spark of magic that's brought us all together.
For the fruit of all creation, thanks be to God. For the gifts to thanks be to God. For the plowing, sowing, reaping, silent growth while we are sleeping, future needs in earth safekeeping, thanks be to God. In the just reward of labor, God's will is done. In the help we give our neighbor, God's will is done. In our worldwide task of caring for the hungry and despairing, in the harvest we are sharing, God's will is done. For the harvests of the Spirit, thanks be to God. For the good we all inherit, thanks be to God. For the wine that still confound us, most of all that love has found us. Thanks be to God.
What do you think of when you hear the word apocalypse? Do you know that word? Apocalypse. It's a fun word to say. Try saying it. Apocalypse. It uses your whole mouth. Maybe some of you think zombies or an asteroid hitting the Earth and only like a few people surviving. Maybe you think doomsday. Well, lots of movies like the theme of apocalypse, so they've made apocalypse to mean those kinds of things. When everything gets wiped out and there's only like a few folks left and they have to start all over. If you Google what apocalypse means, it says the complete final destruction of the world. It sounds terrifying. Well, you can relax and breathe easy. The word actually doesn't mean that at all. It's originally a Greek word, and it means to uncover or reveal. Apocalypse means to uncover or reveal. Thank God. In our Bible story today, Jesus is going to try to teach us about this uncovering or revealing that God is doing. Jesus doesn't use the word apocalypse, but rather the kingdom of God. He uses that phrase, the kingdom of God. I like the reign of God. Not reign like water, but reign like a queendom or a kingdom. He's not going to compare it to zombies, this kingdom of God or this reign of God. He's not going to compare it to meteors from outer space or to doomsday. He's going to say the reign of God is like a seed. Can you see it on my fingertip there? It's a little blurry. The reign of God is like a tiny seed. Our story is from the book of Mark, and his community thousands of years ago believed in the coming, revealing kingdom or reign of God. They believed one day the earth would be just as God wants it to be. Full of peace and harmony and justice. No evil, no suffering. Do you think that's even possible? A world just as God wants it? And if you do think that, how does God create it? How do evil and bad things get wiped away? And what does a seed have to do with it? Well, our brains might melt just thinking about it. And Jesus is trying to help our little minds see what God's reign is like by telling us about seeds. You'll hear Jim read about it later. What we know what a seed is. We know what a seed is, right? We sow this little seed in the ground. We bury it, we might water it, or it might just rain on it, and then we wait. The seed will sprout in its own time. We've done a good thing to plant a seed by planting it, but now it's up to God to produce. Whatever the apocalypse is, the great revealing of a truly good and peaceful world needs us to plant seeds, do good deeds, and wait in faith. And while we wait, we try to live as if God's reign is already here. We don't just wait passively, we wait actively. Plant the seed, trust God is doing something, and live as if it's already done. So I wonder, what good seeds and what good deeds can you do now? Today, that might help God's reign be revealed in the world. We all have that power.
My hometown is Kitchener, Ontario, which is only an hour and a half from London, Ontario, the community in which the horrible tragedy occurred this week, involving the death of that beautiful Muslim family. As I've been coming to terms with how I feel about this horrific incident, I've been doing my best to focus on healing, and that healing is representative in acceptance, compassion, and openness to all.
Like a healing stream in a barren desert, spirit water bringing life to dusty earth, God is trickling through our lives as in a dream unfolding, promising revival and rebirth, like a healing stream. Like a gentle rain on a thirsty garden, spirit water comes to nourish tiny seed. God is bubbling through the soil to coax a new creation, yearning for an end to want and need, like a gentle rain. Like a river strong with a restless current, spirit water rushing on to distant shore, God is carving out a channel in a new direction, calling for an end to hate and war, like a river strong. Like a mighty sea reaching far horizons, spirit water with a love both deep and wide, God is working in our hearts to shape a new tomorrow. God will always challenge and provide, like a mighty sea, like a river strong, like a gentle rain, like a healing stream.
Good morning. Today we have two scripture readings to reflect on together. The first is from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 4, verses 26 to 34. He also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself, first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with a sickle, because the harvest has come." He also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all seeds on the earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches, so that birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables, he spoke the word to them, as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. Our second reading is from the Apostle Paul's second letter to the people of Corinth, chapter 5, verses 6 to 10 and 14 to 17. "So we are always confident, even though that we know while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we do have confidence, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. For all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense for what has been done in the body, whether good or evil. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all, and therefore all have died. And he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view, even though once we knew Christ from a human point of view. We no longer know him in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thanks, Jim, for reading that. And for those of you who watched last Sunday's service, I thought Jim was reading last Sunday, so when I referenced the awesome volunteer scripture reader, I referred to Jim, but of course it was Joan. So sorry, Joan, I missed your involvement last week. But today, I think we're having Jim. Monday is always my day to look ahead to the coming Sunday and what the scriptures are for the lectionary, and to begin to research them and think about them, and then look for connections to the world we're living in and what the scriptures might say and what theme we might have in church on that coming Sunday. And as I was pondering this past Monday in this usual way, I just was suddenly filled with this thought, wait, we're not going to reflect again on the Kamloops Residential School, the 215 children who were buried there in unmarked graves. We're just done with that. And I just had this moment of feeling like, I don't want last Sunday's theme to just be a theme. And I know many of us are continue to be moved by that situation. And so I just thought, maybe there's something in the texts, the scriptures that Jim just read, which are lectionary. They're chosen for us long in advance. And I thought, maybe there's something in them to help us as we continue to reflect on and be in reconciling relationship, I hope, with First Nations people. So I turned my heart to the scriptures in that way. And I think there's something there. So there's some hope. There's a vision of what next, or what we're inside of, or how God is working now through these times. So allow me to go there and allow me to pick up on what we did with Let Us Play earlier in this service. Let me ask you again, do you believe in the coming reign, R-E-I-G-N, or the coming kingdom of God? Do you believe in Mark's apocalypse? That all of creation, at whatever pace, is moving towards ultimate fulfillment and revelation of God's mission, which is total harmony and total peace? And you don't have to, because that's huge. Exactly how do we know that God would be doing that? You know, and the Bible is full of different understandings of apocalypse and revelation. So you don't have to believe that, but I do ask you. An alternative faith place for that, or just worldview, is that you believe that evil and suffering will always be with us. And that may well be. Right, that every new generation of people has the potential to do evil and do good, and we have to learn lessons over, and new evils will emerge, this sort of thing, and it will always be with us. That is another probably totally valid way to understand the arc of time, the arc of the universe. For me, I think I do believe in the coming reign, the coming kingdom of God, not necessarily a return to some sort of paradise, but maybe. And it's just, it's in the Bible so often that my faith sort of just has to go, there must be something to this. And it gives me hope to imagine that all of creation is moving slowly, sometimes too slowly, towards God's apocalypse, uncovering, revealing of a harmonious, peaceful world. Martin Luther King Jr. says it like this: the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. So justice is kind of like that, the magnet, and the God's heart or something, and all of creation bends through time towards being in justice, in harmonious justice, peace and love and all that great stuff. I want to believe that that's true. And I think, for me, I can't imagine that God's reign is a place without suffering of any kind. I think it's helpful maybe to distinguish between two kinds of suffering. I think if God's reign were to come like fully today, it doesn't mean I wouldn't stub my toe. It doesn't mean I couldn't hurt myself if I fall. It doesn't mean if a ship on the sea loses its GPS and its positioning systems that it couldn't hit a rock and sink. Like, the laws of physics will still apply, and there'll still be suffering and loss through those ways. But I think the kind of suffering in God's reign that would be no more is no more evil, no more hatred, no more racism, no indigenous children buried unbeknownst to their families, no children taken from their families, no 20-year-old white man in London, Ontario, driving his vehicle into a family of five with the intent on killing them. That evil would not exist in God's reign. Pure hatred. Based on what? How can someone hate Islam so much that they choose to kill four of them in cold blood? That evil would not be part of God's reign. That suffering would not be there. So what does our little text say today? It seems like a little text, but it's huge, which I suppose is the point. It says that little tiny seeds help us see the little apocalypses of God. In seeds, we can see how the great universe arcs towards justice. And Jesus gives us two little parables to ponder side by side, because each will say something different about this realm of God, this uncovering. The first one is the scatter seed on the ground. It doesn't name the seed. It's not important to name it in this part. Just scatter, someone sows the seed on the ground. And then do what you want, Mr. or Mrs. Sower, but those seeds are now out of your hand, and the germination of those seeds is out of your control. Now the human, the sower, simply must wait. And how the seed is born, we know not. But when the grain is ripe, when the head of the grain is ripe, the sower goes in with the sickle. Built right into this little parable. So we absolutely have a part in God's reign, but the timing of it is not ours, the power of it is not ours, but we must go in and harvest it with our tools. The second parable, the reign of God, is a mustard seed. Okay, so now it is important to name the kind of seed that it is. And it's the kind of seed that is incredibly small, but grows to something great. It's the kind of plant that it doesn't just remain one plant, but it drops all kinds of seeds when it is mature, and mustard just takes over whatever field, whatever part of the land it is in. And not only does it create all these big shrubs, but the branches are so big that birds can come and nest in the shrubs. And the meaning of birds coming to nest is in this huge abundance, this overflowing of life, even more life comes. Like birds lay their eggs, and what are eggs symbolizing? More life, more life, more life. There's a lot in these little parables. But other than the small to the great and the one to the many, why mustard seed? Jesus is decolonizing seeds. He's decolonizing seeds. So the most important seeds to bring about God's reign are not great cedars or oak trees, but small, unwanted, rejected, apparently powerless seeds. And how might these parables be happening today? Is God's reign being uncovered, revealed today? Indigenous voices crying out in grief and anger, seeking justice. Maybe those voices are the scattering, the sowing of the seeds of God's reign, bending us more firmly and surely towards a world of justice and harmony. Those voices, yeah, they've been crying out for decades. They've been shouting for a long time. How much shouting and anguish and pain is required to bring about the kingdom, we know not. But as those voices have been in our midst, whether we've heard them or not, for decades, nowadays, in the last while, other voices are adding to it. Search for more residential school graveyards without markers. In Shubenacadie, last weekend, there was a sonar search for bodies of children that families wonder if they are in the ground, like in Kamloops. And other residential school historic properties across the country have been looking as well. So that's like more scattering, more scattering, more sowing, more sowing. and then settler hearts, those of us that have our hearts moved, those voices of protest and solidarity and friendship, saying we also want to join our voice with our Indigenous sisters and brothers in this work, in this cry for action, in our prayers and our music. We are like spreading through the field. Spreading through the field. Evil was done to these children in the form of racism, horrible abuse, Christocentrism, white supremacy. And where evil is, God's spirit rushes in. Where evil is, God knows exactly where God must be the busiest. And the evil is so great that decades passed and Indigenous parents were ignored, and yet their pain and suffering is the germination of God's reign. What if that's the case? What if that's true, that the pain and suffering, the true indicators of evils in the world, are the germinating points of God's reign? This evil exists so God will grow a new creation where that evil is no more. The power of the kingdom, this harmonious justice world, does not come because finally enough settlers are paying attention, because finally enough settlers of power and privilege have their hearts and resources awakened. The power of God in this little parable is telling us that God uses the love and the brokenness and the strength and the dignity of those whom evil tries to crush and silence. The power of God's reign is Indigenous. The power of God's reign is black and brown and two-spirited. The power of God's reign is queer. And from those points of power, the ripple effect goes out. and good hearts are awakened and broken open from there. But the center is the decolonized center. It's important to, as I'm reflecting, I want to make sure you understand, I'm not saying that God causes evil so God's reign can come. God's not like planting seeds of evil so we can work on justice and figure out how to be together and heaven on earth will come. God does not will any suffering of this kind. The reign of God is needed because people do evil. If we lived in total harmony right now, we wouldn't need a Bible full of visions of apocalypse and new beginnings and new creation and hope for a better world. We wouldn't need that because we'd already be there. But we're not there because the human has power to do evil. Crying out, rising up in compassion, empathy, educating ourselves, and being in solidarity with the oppressed peoples, those are the sickles. Those are the tools of harvest which God gives us to bring in those ripe heads of grain. Well, if the voices and the actions and the dreams of oppressed people are signs of the germinating revelation of God's reign, a love-filled world whose timing we do not fully know, how do we approach living every day as St. Luke's United Church, as me, as you, as a nation, as a globe? While the arc to justice is still bending, as Christians, we say that Christ urges us on. Every day, Christ urges us on. And Paul says, in this time of trusting that God's Spirit is at work in the soil of human goodness, Paul gives us a very special sickle to use. Every day, with every person we meet, we can take this sickle. He says, from now on, we regard no one from a human point of view. Christ was human. Christ was tangible seed. But we saw God do an incredible thing. God transformed Jesus into this eternal life. So the apocalypse has already begun in what we see of the risen life of Christ, which spreads across all. So we know what God can do. Our faith shows us. And now we see every person as a new creation, every person as a new, shining, beloved part of the reality of God. Every person we meet is not just a human. Every person we meet is a reflection of divinity. Every person we meet has the potential to be part of a field full of mustard plants where birds come and nest. Every person is holy. That's our work. When God's glorious uncovering comes, everything old has passed away. See? Everything has become new. Thanks be to God. God bless each one of you and us on the journey.
Plow the fields and scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. God sends a snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine, and soft, refreshing rain. All good gifts around us, the Lord for all God's which thou desirest, our humble thankful hearts. All good gifts around us are sent from heaven above. So thank the Lord, oh thank the I really want to thank you, Lord. I want to thank you, Lord. Thank you for all of your love. I want to thank you, Lord. Lord. Thank you.
For our community prayer today, I invite you to join me in a sung response. And if you feel so comfortable, you could use your bodies too. This is a song from More Voices. It's number 85, if you happen to have a book with you. But the words will be on the screen. So you start with your hands out here, and you're going to bring them together. And then the second action is, if I was standing up, you'd see I'm going to do this with my hands, and then bring them up above my head like I'm digging into the soil and bringing them up. And then the third set of actions are, set your seal upon my heart. So forehead, mouth, heart. And then keep your hand there and make a cross on your chest with the other hand. All right? So it goes like this. Take, oh, take me as I am. And then we dig. Summon out what I shall be. And then set your seal upon my heart and live in me. Try it again. Take, oh, take me as I am. Summon out what I shall be. Set your seal upon my heart and live in me. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for loving us as we are and calling us into your new creation. Help us as a church and a wider community to listen to and respond with the voices crying out for an end to racism, to white supremacy, to Islamophobia, and heterosexism. guide us as we do Christ's work in these ways. Here we go. Take, oh, take me as I am. Summon out what I shall be. Set your seal upon my heart and live in me. Creator God, call us anew to care for the earth and all the beings who make this planet home, and for the ecosystems that are intertwined with each living thing. Your revelation will also mean that the natural world is at peace and no longer harmed by evil human deeds. 3, 4. Take, oh, take me as I am. Summon out what I shall be. Set your seal upon my heart and live in me. Holy One, we pray for those who are sick at home or in hospital, for those suffering with mental health issues and dementia, and surround those grieving the loss of a loved one with your eternal love and comfort. 3, 4. Take, oh, take me as I am. Summon out what I shall be. Set your seal upon my heart and live in me. God, we give thanks for all the young people who are completing another year of school in this pandemic. Some of them graduating. Bless them with rest and rejuvenation and safe socializing and fun and joy over the summer. 3, 4. Take, oh, take me as I am. Summon out what I shall be. Set your seal upon my heart and live in me. We pray now the prayer of Jesus, which is ingrained on our hearts and holds the seeds to life on earth as it is in heaven. Let us pray. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Love truly is a balm, a salve. And as we continue to integrate the difficult news throughout the past couple weeks, I ask us all, to the best of our ability as a community, to embrace love.
Love divine, all love's excelling, joy of heaven to earth come down. Fix in us thy humble dwelling, all thy faithful mercies crown. Jesus, thou art all compassion, pure unbounded love thou art. Visit us with thy salvation and our every trembling heart. Come, Almighty, to deliver by grace receive. Suddenly he returned, and never, never more thy temples leave.
Thank you for worshiping with us today. If you're watching this before 11:30 on a Sunday morning, there is a Zoom coffee hour, which anyone is welcome to if you have the link provided by Elaine on Church at Work. It's at the stlukesunited.ca webpage as well. You could find it there. Unfortunately, I'm going to miss being with coffee hour again this week. Last week I was moving, and today I'm going to be with the kids physically, the children, as they drive through the parking lot to pick up a special lunch prepared by MJ and also helped by Pat Swim. So I'll see the children there at 11:30, and congratulations to anyone who is graduating from one grade, moving on to another, and anyone who is graduating from high school or university or one level of school to another. Well done during this difficult pandemic time of learning. Friends, let's go in peace to love and serve the world as God calls us to, with the many gifts and tools we have to serve. Amen, 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 hallelujah, amen, 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 one more time, amen, 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 amen.